some of the fundamental ideas in Africana studies and allow students to read widely so they can begin to develop their repertoire material, but also teaching at the same time an undergrad course in Black women in political leadership, many of them are here, and having a really wonderful time of engaging another generation with ideas about activism, leadership, and how all these things connect to intellectual work, particularly in this time that we're living in. So one of the benefits of having really amazing students who then go on to do way better work than you do is having Greg Thomas, who was one of my students at Binghamton University and now is a prof, first at Syracuse University and now at Tufts, and is an amazing winter scholar who does work on Sylvia Winter, used to do work on hip-hop, actually brought Lil Kim to campus and created a big drama. He was one of the first people to do that at Syracuse University. They actually got listed on this negative list of 101 professors you should be afraid of. It's not a name of the legend.
So you're one of the most dangerous academics in America.
I'm the most dangerous academics in America. This is one right here. Are you not on the new list?
I haven't seen
it. Oh. And then relatedly, we had the support for this talk this evening of the Ithaca Committee for Justice in Palestine, who did a lot of work in circulating the lecture to the community. And so we're pleased to have you here. Welcome, and also Jewish Voice for Peace. Their material is outside, so make sure you pick up some of the flyers and material that is being circulated out there. So part, as I said, the benefit of teaching this graduate course also is to have a new crop of wonderful students. One of them is Amaris Brown, who will introduce our speaker for this evening, Amaris.
No mic. Okay. I wasn't trained to predict, so. Okay, so thank you. I'm so excited that I get to introduce you yet again. This is Dr. Greg Thomas, who's an associate professor of African American literature at Tufts University. He is also an activist and a curator of carceral thought. He received his PhD in rhetoric from the University of California, Berkeley, and a master's in philosophy. Am I doing okay?
Yes.
And a master's in philosophy from SUNY Binghamton University. He also holds a BA in French from Randolph-Macon College. Dr. Thomas researches race and empire, global African literature, body politics, epistemology. He studies music and film, Black radical traditions globally. He is also a scholar of colonial and anti-colonial thought. Dr. Thomas is the founding editor of Proud Flesh, a new African journal of culture, politics, and consciousness, which has remained from its premier issue in 2002, committed to the production of, in Thomas's own words, seeking out revolutionary words and striving to make them flesh. I just every time. And as I said, which is a really interesting way for us as scholars and thinkers to think about archiving. Dr. Thomas is the author of The Sexual Demon of Colonial Power, Pan-African Embodiment, and Erotic Schemes of Empire, which was published in 2007, as well as Hip Hop Revolution in the Flesh, Power, Knowledge, and Pleasure in Lil Kim's Lyricism, which was published in 2009. Dr. Thomas is also the co-editor with L.H. Stallings of Word Hustle, Critical Essays and Reflections on the Works of Donald Goins, which was published in 2011. Professor Greg Thomas has published several essays in periodicals such as Presence Africaine, Human Architecture, Journal of West Indian Literature, Gender Journal, the New Centennial Review, the CLR James Journal, Journal of Pan-Africanist Studies, African Literature Today, Words, Beats, Life, Small Acts, and Black Camera, an international film journal. Currently, he is at work on a book manuscript on the writings of Black Panther revolutionary and iconic political prisoner, George L. Jackson. And so for today, Dr. Thomas has curated the international exhibition George Jackson in the Sun of Palestine, which opened October 20th of 2015 for the Abu Jihad Museum for Political Prisoner Affairs in the Abu Dis campus of Al-Quds University in Palestine and has since traveled to Oakland. Most recently, the exhibition was hosted by the African Community Center in the Old City of Jerusalem, as well as the Habashi Habashi Theater in Haifa. The exhibition includes drawings, woodcuts, political posters, and other art depicting Jackson's life and the Palestinian and U.S. prisoners' political consciousness. Some of these include letters of solidarity between Palestinian and American prisoners. In a recent interview with the Electronic Intifada, an independent online news publication and educational resource focusing on Palestine as people, politics, culture, Thomas explains that the exhibition works to uncover a, quote, language of political captivity that informs a diasporic revolutionary kinship. So Dr. Thomas is giving us a way to think transnationally about the function and exchange of revolutionary knowledge and of revolutionary consciousness. And so without further ado, thank you.
No mics needed, but I have some images for you, so I can stand a little bit over here to DJ the images while I speak to you. So I don't like counting years, especially in academia, they get away. But a few years back, I started a research project that probably started years ago, the very first time I read George Jackson and Soledad Brother, these poetic prison letters, which I will let a few others actually reintroduce to you, just in case you don't remember them. But I remember my first contact when I was very disaffected in graduate school and reading outside of the curriculum of miseducation, how taken I was by this. At that very moment, I knew this would go somewhere. I didn't know when, I didn't need to predict when, but I knew I would do something with George Jackson sooner or later. And I turned to do some research for this project. I want to write a book on the writings of George Jackson. I'm not interested in just reducing him to a symbolic icon, right, or a function of something else, but I wanted to talk about these writings that captivate people from the captivity of prisons. And I wanted to research that. I didn't want to pontificate over the lines, just like pick out the two books and read from cover to cover and like talk to myself. But instead I wanted to learn as much as I could, to do as many interviews with his ex-comrades, his former comrades who are still alive, in the party, in the prison, like, et cetera, independent journalists and what have you, who cover the movements that he was a part of in the San Francisco Bay Area, especially. Looking at periodicals that you can't, like, index in the system and say, okay, I want this issue from this journal. He's got to walk into the dungeon and, like, comb through those things, like, for hours and hours and hours and hope you don't give up before you miss something crucial, right? And so I started that process. And in the midst of that process, I got hijacked by another process. One project gave birth to another, right, with no family planning. And this turned out, which wasn't necessary, and it's not in my tradition anyway. So I found this connection between George Jackson and the poetry of Palestinian resistance, right? And it happened, it was all fortuitous. It happened right around the time I was about to make my first trip to Palestine as a part of an academic delegation that would go to five different universities in the West Bank and meet with all kinds. And so I went armed with the story that I'm going to tell you about. And the response to this story was amazed and amazing, right? And the last time I told the story was at this museum for the prisoner movement in Palestine. The very idea of it floored me. And then the sight of it and the experience of it floored me. And when I tell the same story that I'm about to share with you there, right, someone goes, let's do an exhibition in a very Palestinian way. Let's do an exhibition. And then I thought about nothing else for the next year, right? And then it's amazing because I first started telling the story of wanting and trying and planning to do the exhibition, and now I'm telling the story on the other side of what began as a political fantasy for me and now it's become so much more. And so this other project was born, which was the exhibition itself, which has now been traveling the world. It began in Jerusalem proper, the part of Jerusalem that Zionism doesn't want us to think of as Jerusalem anymore, the village of Abu Dis, for example, that is now separated from the rest of Jerusalem by an apartheid wall that's, what, 25 feet high. So people are now separated from the schools that they went to and the hospitals that would have served them and their family members, right, by this 25-foot wall. But it's Jerusalem, nonetheless. And then it went other places. It's come to Oakland twice, right? First to the warehouse, the body shop that becomes a gallery space, like at night, across from the Oakland-Palestine Solidarity Room. right, Uptown. And then later on, more recently in this past October, at the 50th anniversary conference and gala of the Black Panther Party, that was at the Oakland Museum for 3 days. We've also gone back to Palestine to cross the artificial colonialist divisions of Palestine, so that we've now exhibited also in Haifa, right, as the great introduction, like, told you, at Hashemi Theater. And I'll save some surprises for you. And we're planning to do more, we're looking to do more, to be faithful to this movement, to these movements, and one place that is on deck next is actually Vienna, Austria. So I want to talk about that project. And then one project gave birth to another. I can't stop having children. I undertook a research project based on the exhibition. I heard from Palestinian ex-prisoners, right, who talk like old black people talk. One of them told his younger brother, who's my friend, that he was in conversation with a bunch of his, like, comrades, and they were talking about the exhibition. They were trying to come to the opening in October of 2015, but a lot was going on in 2015. And here, we tend to use the term political prisoner as if you get in, you know, they might keep you for 30 years, 40 years, they probably won't let you out, but if they do, you know, it's after 30 or 40 years or something like that. Well, in Palestine, there's like this phenomenon of rearrest. Right, like by Zionism. So you can say I'm a political prisoner of 20 years, but you did three stints, like 5, 5, and 5, right? Like, or 10, 2, depending. And so during times of arrest, they often rearrest. People are profiled based upon imprisonment status. I've been on minibuses in Nablus, for example, where they stop you at checkpoints, and then some fool just walks up to the window and goes, "You've been in prison? You've been in prison?" Like, and they'll snatch you off, right? But it's a militarized checkpoint, supported by all kinds of Western and especially U.S. technology. So if you're Palestinian, you've been in prison, it's in the system, they take your ID, they know, they put you up, they can beat you at a checkpoint, they can re-imprison you. So at that particular point, they didn't come, right, to the exhibition, but they were talking about it, I hear, right? And so my friend says to me, yeah, they were talking about the exhibition, they said, it was nice, it was great, it was a good thing. So what's next? I'm like, okay, right? And so the next child ended up being a research project where I would go back to Palestine for an extended period of time, for 3 to 4 months, in fact, where I would do interviews with ex-detainees, ex-prisoners, ex-captives in Palestine, and talk specifically about the internationalism of the heyday of their movement and the connections that we can make, that they've already made, that we can make further with black movements and black political prisons in North America that are, of course, denied by the white racist state of the United States of America. So these are the children. And so here we have a martyr stencil done for George Jackson that we see now from Bethlehem here today, a martyr stencil for George Jackson that signifies immortality. And the working project that began it all, the working title was The Immortal George Jackson. I feel like we have to reintroduce him now, since counter-revolution and counter-revolutionary history erases our most radical traditions from easy access, right? But George Jackson was born on September 23rd, 1941, in prison for the last time at the age of 18 for an alleged $70 robbery. He was sentenced to 1 year to life for an alleged $7 robbery. His political education turned that sentence into a life sentence, even a death sentence. Assassinated at the age of 29 at San Quentin Prison on August 21st, 1971, George Lester Jackson was first and foremost a revolutionary, a thinker, a theoretician of revolutionary ideas, an organizer of revolutionary bodies. He's the Malcolm X who doesn't get out and who organizes within the prison system, amazingly. A writer of revolutionary literature, a long-term prisoner as a result of his revolutionary commitment, and a revolutionary icon or inspiration for his contemporaries and many more generations to come, most especially, though far from exclusively, in the black world of the African diaspora. I like talking about George Jackson and Africana, like at Cornell, because he represents black studies in arms. Armed black studies, right? So that brother, the first book that brought him to the outside world. When Huey P. Newton first went to prison as the leader of the Black Panther Party, he found out instantly that there was a giant and a legend inside the California prison system whose name was George Jackson. Were it not for these books and the Black Panther Party, we could have missed him, even though this was a giant and a legend. The first book, which reminds me of the Confessions of Nat Turner, because it was mutilated. It was mutilated. It's not the book that it was supposed to be, but it was published in 1970. It became a worldwide phenomenon. 20 translations in different languages, introduced by Jean Genet, for example. We can talk more about the second book, where he wanted to reestablish his own voice without white, liberal, white, literary, white, legal interference, right, in The Voice. Unlike Nat Turner, he got to write back, right, after Thomas Gray did what he did and called his text a confession, right, and tried to ventriloquize him to placate audiences that were living slavocracy. And notice in this mass market paperback edition, the publication includes a photostat note page where he says, I'm not a writer, but all of it's me the way I want it, the way I see it, George L. Jackson. Right? I'm not a writer, meaning I'm not a bourgeois writer. I'm not a writer who writes for the sake of art, for art's sake, right? But I write as a tool in this complex of activity that I do that makes me a revolutionary. Jean Genet said in his preface that what follows must be read as a manifesto, as a tract, as a call to rebellion, since it's that first of all. He called it a striking poem of love and combat, right? A phrase which has been repeated many times to describe this collection of prose letters that are extreme, not just poetic, but lyrical. Lyrical. And he didn't choose the form because, of course, the form is dictated by the prison. You can take one piece of paper, write on both sides, it must be 8x11, yellow legal paper, etc. Unless you end up writing through your lawyer, which sometimes he did, and sometimes Poe spoke as lawyers, so he could get other communiques out. That is Jean Genet, the French literary giant and outcast himself. Then Julius Lester, who's not Jean Genet, but writes in the New York Times Book Review, this book is composed of letters to his mother, his father, his younger brother Jonathan, Angela Davis Faye Stender, his attorney, and others from 1964 until 2 days after Jonathan's death. His younger brother was martyred at the age of 17, trying to liberate him from prison when he stormed the courtroom, armed himself, and took a judge, DA, three jurors hostage. But did not survive it, survived it in terms of immortality. Together, they comprise one of the most significant and important documents since the first black was pushed off the ship at Jamestown Colony. George Jackson says he's not a writer, but he gets New York Times book reviews that bourgeois writers couldn't dream of. And then C.L.R. James, the great, himself, he wrote in Radical America, check this one. Jackson was in prison at the age of 18 and was shot and killed in prison at the age of 28. Of the 10 years that he spent in prison, 7 were spent in solitary confinement. The letters of Soledad Brother are, in my opinion, the most remarkable political documents that have appeared inside or outside the United States since the death of Lyndon. Not inside or outside of prison either, right? But the United States, inside or outside, since the death of Lyndon. This is George Jackson in translation, in French translations in particular, translations that continue with new additions, as it turns out. And Huey P. Newton himself referred to George Jackson as the greatest writer of us all. Huey P. Newton had written what was supposed to be an introduction to Soledad Brother before the Jean Genet text was secured, an introduction he wrote from Brazil, actually. And Huey P. Newton's statement was transformed into blurb material, where he noted that he was the greatest writer of us all. I mean, when we think about the social movements, the revolutionary social movements of the 1960s and the 70s, and the kind of political intellectual production that we got from it, like, this is amazing, because this produced the greatest writing of all. And within that, Huey P. Newton is saying George Jackson, obviously, right, is the greatest writer of the greatest writers of us all. And he concluded when he reviewed Blood in My Eye, which white liberals left alone, and certainly black all liberals left alone, right, he said, the dragon has spoken, and his fire moves across the land and the sea. It actually sounds like the irritating genie of the Haitian Revolution. Here are the current reprints of George Jackson. When Blood in My Eye was brought back into print in 1980, by Black Classic Press, founded and edited by Paul Cope, the former Panther himself, right, of the Maryland chapter of the Black Panther Party based in Baltimore. It was followed then quickly with the aid of Jonathan Jackson Jr. in 1994. Lawrence Hill Press would bring Soledad Brother back into print, and interestingly enough, they would never leave print since. Right? When I talked to someone like Heidi Garima at the Sankofa Bookstore, I said, what books do you sell the most, like in this, you know, amazing community here, just like Présence Africaine in Paris. He goes, easy by far. It's Blood in My Eye by George Jackson and Assata Shakur's autobiography, right? So things would get flipped in a certain kind of way, right? The liberal cause celebrate text of the mutilated Soledad Brother, right? Would not, you know, live as long or as fearsomely, right? As the text that liberalism has always tried to avoid, Blood in My Eye. And one of the things that I found in the dungeon that I just want to share with you because I love it so much, right? It also reintroduces George Jackson, is this particular statement. So there was a leaflet that was made for the Soledad Brothers Defense Committee, right? Soledad was the name of the prison. that George Jackson caught his last case in from within the prison itself. And as a result of this case, he and two other black prisoners were arbitrarily put on trial, although George Jackson was absolutely proud of all of his political resistance, right? And they became known as the Soledad Brothers. And George Jackson's first collection was known as Soledad Brother. And so the Soledad Brother Defense Committee, right, they put out a pamphlet, and the pamphlet basically looked like three heads with some text under it, right? So the brothers were John Clichette, as well as Fleeta Drumgo and George Jackson. So it was like a stat sheet in the main, right? So it had a headshot of John Clichette, and John Clichette is, 20-some years old, he's from this state, and this is his charge, etc. Same thing Fleeta Drumgo, he comes from here, this is his charge, how long he's been in, etc. And a kind of victimology, too, at the same time. For George Jackson, you don't get stats, instead you get a philosophical statement. The statement says, I'm a very orthodox communist. Dirty, dirty red. I'm for materialism, dialectics, internationalism, women's liberation, full automation, welfare distribution, one party, standardized universal education, anti-military, from all according to ability, to all according to need. Free love, meaning, as far as I'm concerned, the breakdown of what we think of as the family unit. Today, I'm every woman's man, every woman is my woman. All children are mine to be loved equally, and every man who wouldn't object to my existence will be my brother. No mystifications. Mm-hmm. Unknown things, appeared, and seemed to be kissing. So that's a reintroduction of George Jackson. So in October 20th, 2015, I go back to launch the exhibit, right? To mount the exhibit, to launch the exhibit, to open it, too, with a symposium at the Abuja Hot Center, which we'll see about. October was an interesting time because there was a kind of intifada going on. And it wasn't a polite intifada, right? Oftentimes we phrase or frame Palestinian resistance, we talk and show the slingshot, right? Or the rock, right? And that can actually get kind of problematic, even kind of masochistic in the way it's framed, right? This intifada was an intifada of the knife, on the streets. Okay? And there was giant backlash for it, right? So when we went to open the exhibit, on no given day did I know that I could get to this campus, right, where this museum, this center, is located. Every other day, it was yes or no, or maybe God knows, right? We had no idea if this would ever happen, right? I was there for 3 weeks to do this, and time was short, and we were just hoping. And the whole idea was, if it happens, it'll be priceless, right? And the whole struggle, is worth it. So this is what the center looks like from a couple of angles. It was actually designed by Al-Quds University architects and opened in about 2007. It began as a small apartment building in Ramallah, and now it's this institution. This is what it looks like from the back. Of course, Al-Quds University means Jerusalem. Al-Quds means Jerusalem. A lot of us celebrate Quds Day, for example. But they get no accreditation recognition from the Israelis, because the Israelis want them to change the name of the university. They don't want to say that there's a Palestinian Arab university in Jerusalem named Jerusalem, right? And this poses all kinds of problems because the market, the economy is controlled, right, by the occupation. So if you have a degree from here, the occupation doesn't recognize it. It's very significant in a number of ways. It plays out in a number of ways. Translation is very interesting here because although the first sign says it's the Museum of the Prisoner Movement Affairs, right? What we see elsewhere is a translation that speaks directly to George Jackson, where it's translated as the Abushiha Center, not Museum, for the Palestinian Captives Movement. And George Jackson frames his imprisonment as captivity, our imprisonment as captivity, which also doesn't allow us to leave slavery behind, right? But frames it as captivity, not the more liberal language of a prison industrial complex, but captivity that keeps you from separating incarceration from colonialism, from capitalism, from imperialism, and slavery as well. This is very key, and this is precisely the language that is used in Palestine. My argument in general is that George Jackson makes infinitely more sense in Palestine than he can ever make sense in the mainline of the United States. He writes himself, George, and so did that brother, the introduction, the introductory letter that's amazing, but actually was cut, two-thirds of it, three-fourths of it are missing to this day. Right, we need a magical restored issue, edition of Soledad Brother. He writes, black men born in the U.S. and fortunate enough to live past the age of 18 are conditioned to accept the inevitability of prison. For most of us, it simply looms as the next sequence, phase in a sequence of humiliations. Being born a slave in a captive society and never experiencing any objective basis for expectation had the effect of preparing me for the progressively traumatic misfortunes that lead so many black men to the prison gangs. I was prepared for prison. It required only minor psychological adjustments, right? You can replace black with Palestinian and vice versa as you can in so many contexts, right? In fact, when you look at the statistics involved with this sort of thing, this is what you see, that like one out of five Palestinians has seen like the inside of prison, and then when you talk about young Palestinian males, the number is like 40% and not 20%, right? Same thing here in terms of black men specifically, it's like one in three will see prison and not, interestingly enough, in terms of the juxtapositions. With the assassination of George Jackson, it was framed just as such by the Black Panther Party. They have the Revolutionary Memorial Service. Two of the most amazing issues of the amazing Black Panther Party newspaper are devoted to George Jackson. The second one emblazes a slogan that is concocted by Huey P. Newton and sticks with us to this day, where they say George Jackson's not dead. No, but George Jackson lives. And then this is something I discovered in my research. I found there's a book list in these legal papers I was perusing and that I won't tell you much more about. So after the assassination, kind of in the tradition of Ida B. Wells, it didn't go as the assassinators really wanted it to go, right? So Ida B. Wells tells us that if someone comes to take you down, you make sure you don't go down alone. This is what happened on August 21st, 1971, right? There are six casualties and they're not just George Jackson. In fact, the prisoners, he and his comrades in this maximum security area of the maximum security prison called the Adjustment Center, in Orwellian language, right? They took over that section of the prison during this attempted massacre for a half an hour. They often call it, in retrospect, their half hour of freedom, okay? And the prison system remains so traumatized by this every August 21st. They are traumatized by this. They're traumatized by the name of George Jackson. They criminalize the use of the name George Jackson. To this day, ever more so, in fact, have judicial appellate decisions that back them up. If I write you a letter in the California prison system that is now extending, you know, nationwide, and I use the name George Jackson, and I'm talking about your cousin, you will be sent to the hold. You'll be classified as a security risk, right? They call you a gang risk, which they literally translate as security risk, right? There's not a separation between, like, gang and terrorist. The translation is made, in fact, by the U.S. state. So I happen to, upon this text, for most of the prisoners, again, the cells, they did digest. They went in with machine guns, they searched the cells, they did digest, they sent them to the warden. For most prisoners, it was like a paperclip, half a pencil, you know, a piece of paper, and half a bar of soap. For George Jackson, it ended up being a list of 99 books. 99 books in the prison cell that was 8 by 6 feet. 99 books in the prison cell that today would only permit 13 books in the main line of the prison and 3 books in the Adjustment Center. The Adjustment Center in San Quentin today is now death row for the whole state of California because it signified death all along, all right? So this list, I'm talking to one of the San Quentin Six, he explains what it is to me, and then I start thinking about it. I'm looking at the list, the books are amazing. This is also his kind of bibliography for the study he was undertaking when he was working on Blood in My Eye, which was smuggled out in manuscript form only weeks before the assassination. And it was sent to Random House, which published it, where Toni Morrison is editor, right? And it had instructions based upon what was done on Soledad Brother. Do not touch this book. It was published as is. All right. One of the books on the list, I don't know why it captivated me, but I think I know why, right, was Enemy of the Sun, Poetry of Palestinian Resistance, published by Drummond Spear Press, edited by Nasir Aruri and Edmund Arif. Okay? It rang a bell because, like many young people, I had perused the papers of the Black Panther Party. And I had seen something else. I'd seen this, which we'll come back to. Right? But on the strength of looking at the list, I ordered the book used off Amazon, which is not a plug. And it just said Enemy of the Sun. It abbreviated the co-editor's name. There was no subtitle. I didn't know what it was, but it rang a bell. It's a lot of spiritual communication in this project, right? It comes, I see it, and I'm like, oh my God. Oh my God. And I remember the other poem. The title poem is by Samuel Qasim. I would venture to say that every Palestinian who's ever read a word knows the poem. It's sort of like a Langston Hughes poem that we would know here. You hear in church recited all the time. Right? One stanza, you may take the last strip of my land, feed my youth to prison cells, you may plunder my heritage, you may burn my books, my poems, or feed my flesh to the dogs. You may spread a web of terror on the roofs of my village, O enemy of the sun. But I shall not compromise, until the last pulse in my veins I shall resist. Samuel Acosta, who's known as identified with the resistance poetry category of Literature Day. Something happened. A lot of it's enshrouded in mystery, which is apt, like I think, right? George Jackson not only had that book and many others, more than 99, in fact, in his cell. He lent them out to other prisoners. This was a guerrilla underground library. But like most prisoners in Palestine and other places as well as here, they also transcribed material from books onto blank pieces of paper, right? Which circulated among their comrades as contraband material, right? We have often hear prisoners who get out of prison and come across a book and go, oh, I already read this. I read this in prison. I just didn't know what it was. And it was the second chapter of Das Kapital, like by Marx, right? And when I interview Palestinian prisoners, like, oh yeah, we did that all the time. You know, we put shit everywhere, on walls, on napkins, you know, things from Ireland, like without title, without author, that were collective, especially when it comes from an anti-communist collective, anti-capitalist or communist collective ethos. And so we can guess, we can speculate that George Jackson not only had the book which he circulated, as a teacher of Samuel Acosta and Palestinian literature in San Quentin prison, but also that he probably transcribed some of the poetry down on pieces of paper and shared it. His mother's reaction to his assassination was immediate and very, very interesting. The first thing she wanted was his things. She heard about it on the radio, went to the prison gate, and she wanted his things. And his political party, the Black Panthers, published his things, right, in their newspaper for months to come. And then in September 28th of the Black Panther newspaper, we see this poem, Enemy of the Sun, by George Jackson. Right? It's the poem taken from the book of Palestinian resistance poetry. And it's from the title poem, Samuel Qasem, but it's actually not just that. The son of Samuel Qasem came to the opening, Watan El Qasem, and he was looking at the poster we made of this image. And he puts his finger on it and goes, oh, this is not just one poem. And this was the first time I noticed this, right? He said, this is two poems, right? And then I realized actually it's three. The first column is actually Enemy of the Sun, right? Then in the second column, two-thirds of it is another poem called I Defy. And these are kin poems, even twin poems. I see them as a suite. In the same way that no matter what I do, I can't separate Bob Marley's Brennan and Luton from Bob Marley's Slave Driver. They're just one song. All right? And then the last piece here is from a piece called Farewell to Sophie. Right? So did he collect these poems and transcribe El Qasem in particular and correspond as he did to all of his correspondents, right, to circulate this material? Did Huey P. Newton do this, right, because he and George Jackson were talking about Samuel El Qasem, and this is a mystic hand immortalizing him, making this connection that only the aware would see, like, or hear? Like, we don't know. I think it's aptly shrouded, like in mystery, but the connection is profound. And this is a story that I was sharing that I just discovered in my first trip, right? And at the end of that first trip, like I said, someone said, well, let's do an exhibition, all right? So this tale is the center of the exhibition project. Here is the invitation that, of course, like I sent, you know, to people back here, hoping they could get to Applebee's real quick. You know, I sent it to Paul Coates at Black Classic Press. He emailed me back immediately, like right on. Sent it to one of the San Quentin Six, right, David Johnson. And he has a statement. He replies with a statement of his support for Palestinian liberation by all means, etc. This is what we were working in the middle of. These are Al-Quds University students on the wall. That's 10 feet from their campus, right? Whenever there's any resistance in the street, the Zionists attack the universities, especially when students are involved. I learned something there. So here I'm used to hearing that the suspect is black and male and wearing a hoodie, right? Writ large there, the suspect is, of course, Palestinian, Arab, and Muslim, right? And they say, and he went to Al-Quds University, and this is his village. So they try to demolish his home in the village, and they go and attack the university by morning, if not the afternoon. This is what happens. And this was the circumstances under which we were mounting the exhibition. But interestingly enough, we were trying to do a lot of translation work beforehand. And we worked most closely at that particular point with two young Palestinian women students who were helping us translate several pages of George Jackson's words from English into Arabic. And as soon as I met them, both of them separately, they both walked up to me with giant eyeballs and said that everything that they were reading by George Jackson and translating was happening in the streets of the West Bank now. Right? And so this is what the beginnings of the setup looked like with my colleague, Mohammed Jamous, in this amazing building. And this was the first international exhibition curated, right, by someone who was not part of the museum. And this is the opening with some serious figures here, actually. We'll talk a little bit further. We had a ribbon ceremony. I want to give you an image of George Jackson and Sylvia Costum, right? So again, I'll make the point. I'll say this is like if a poem of Langston Hughes turned up in Palestine and then was translated and published in a Palestinian periodical as the poem of a Palestinian political prisoner. In terms of the stature of the poem itself, and here is the son of Waqtan al-Qasim. I got to meet his wife and his other brother. It was really amazing. I expected none of this to happen. It was a completely unexpected pregnancy. The theme of the son is very key because it was one that was shared across all kinds of struggles across the so-called third world, right? And in all kinds of genres, as a fact. If you go to the American University in Beirut, which is a huge archive center, as I did in Lebanon, then you'll see, for example, a lot of PLO posters that use the symbol, right? As did Emery Douglas, the Black Panther revolutionary artist and minister of culture. Here are some of the collections from the PLO. See, the creative uses of the sun as a symbol of life and freedom, right? Revolution for life and freedom. Sometimes the sun turns red, as it did not only for these PLO posters, but also for this RNA, Republic of New Africa, poster, which happens after 1980. It doesn't just go to visual text or scribal literary text, but also music. For example, if you go to Elaine Brown's music, she writes and sings as a songstress and songwriter of Songs of Liberation. You tell me that the sun belongs to you and should surround you. Yet when I turn to look, I see they've snatched the sun from all around you. If you love the sun, it's where you come from, then you'd better dare to seize the time. The time is now. Oh, seize the time, and you know how, right? So the seize the time slogan that we see all over the place, right, as a type of Bobby Seale's autobiography coming from her, like songbook, like itself, even like going on in the future. You can see Biggie Smalls' songs where he uses like sky's the limit, seize the time. Also, if you don't know 47 Soul, you gotta go check them out, right? It's a kind of neo-Dabke group that makes amazing music, right? And one of their earlier songs, they say, from Africa to Palestine, the sunlight will shine, right? So this is no accidental symbol, Enemy of the Sun. But I do want to say one other thing about the book. The Enemy of the Sun collection was published by Drum and Spear Press. It was published by a black press based in Washington, D.C., a black anti-imperialist press founded by ex-SNCC members, right? And it's specifically Charles Cobb, right, who's recently published that book, This Nonviolent Stuff Will Get You Killed. Right? This was a collective that published it. I've since learned from interviews with Edmund Arif that they were rejected by 12 publishers in the US. Most of these poets had not been brought together in this collection before, and certainly not in English translation. And they got one acceptance, and then after the editor went to like the board, they were like, hell no, and they got a rejection again. And so were it not for this black Palestinian connection from an earlier time, this collection would not exist, and it still wouldn't exist in English. Okay? So this is key, and it is tied to the earlier history, the longer history of anti-Zionism that we see with Kwame Ture, the former Stokely Carmichael in particular, this publication, and this black Palestinian and Panther-Palestinian connection. So that connection is key. They're embedded, and one of the general points I want to make is that these connections go way, way, way beyond Twitter, like Ann Ferguson, right, and what happened. They're longer and wider, deeper, and more profound. One of the things that I found, one of my questions for my interviews in this 3-month, 4-month long project, certainly dealt with Fanon. And I came across almost haphazardly the first Arabic edition of The Wretched of the Earth, which is what you see here next to this other image of Fanon. And it's a nice pan-Arab thing, right? Like it's published in Beirut, the artwork is Syrian. No, the translator is from Beirut, the artwork is Syrian, and the publication was Iraq, okay? And interestingly enough, in Arabic, a literal translation that they use here is not the wretched of the earth, or the damned of the earth, or the condemned of the earth, it's the tortured of the earth. It makes all kinds of sense in this context, right? There's a concept of samud that's used in Palestine. It's sometimes roughly gets translated as steadfastness, resilience. Right? At all levels, the most micro-political levels, the broadest cultural levels, right? Concretely, it also means like no, not confession. No confession during interrogation, right? And also like no snitching on political comrades and what have you. Samud, right? And if you've seen the Battle of Algiers, you guys have seen the Battle of Algiers, remember, we learned in the Battle of Algiers that the general policy in the revolutionary movements was that when a captive was captured, you give the movement 24 hours of resistance during torture and interrogation. 24 hours to move shit, change it up, etc. 24 hours we need, right? And then you don't need to die. You don't need to like endure any further, right? You can sell whatever they extract from you through this physical colonial violence, right? Well, the Palestinian movement took that further and said no confession at all, right? And made this a culture like in and of itself. And this is Samud. This is Samud. And you see this. Samud is also defined as not breaking during interrogation. You see this, right? Susan Abu Hawa says that the Palestinian movement always has a very strong identification with the black struggle because for them, blackness represents Samud. This is what Susan Abu Hawa like writes here. And I think you see Samud writ large all over George Jackson, as George Jackson is projected, for example, in the film of Haida Gerima, right? The first three films of Haida Gerima does as a student is a trilogy dialogue with the writings of George Jackson, with the significance of George Jackson. And the second film, Child of Resistance, which is just amazing, he has this credit sequence that doesn't stop blowing my mind, right? The 45-minute movie is over. It's about a female political prisoner who was cast in George Jackson's image and iconography. And at the end, she rolls the credits, and there's a monologue that she speaks softly and slowly over the credits, even as the credits disappear and the screen fades to black. And you can't quite figure when the film is over, right? When the sequence stops, right, we noticed that the credits were actually broadcast on what an image that looked like a prison wall. The prison wall that you see through the film becomes a backdrop for the presence, the credits, which is scribbled on it, okay? And then the credits stop, fades to black, but she keeps talking, and then the fade to black fades, and you see the wall again. And all of a sudden, he broadcasts a quote from George Jackson. You find out it's from George Jackson, a long quote. He says, this is what the figure looks like, who's a female figure, but given us George, and then this quote, slowly, you have to figure out that it's George, right? If I leave here alive, I'll leave nothing behind. They'll never count me among the broken men, one of the most famous lines from George Jackson's text. But I can't say that I'm normal either. I've been hungry too long, I've gotten angry too often, I've been lied to and insulted too many times. They pushed me over the line of no retreat, from which there can be no retreat. George Jackson. This happens after the credit sequence, and then Haida Gerima signs his name in the place of George Jackson itself. And this line about being pushed over the line of no retreat is exactly how today, in 2017, right, the DVD packaging of Bush Mama Child of Resistance and Hourglass gets presented to us today. The copy is still framing this in terms of George. All right. So we were supposed to open the exhibit and launch it with support, with events, right, with work, like across the West Bank in particular. It was very hard to do. The day after the opening, we were supposed to go to Brzezinski University near Ramallah, right? But every checkpoint had been closed by the Israelis and there was no travel. Like, we were trying to figure out why this rental car is not coming. Like, I got here at 9, we're supposed to leave at 11, where the hell is he? We find another car and we try to travel every checkpoint. So we get to Brzezinski 2 hours late, we have to postpone. We meet with radical faculty, right? And we plan an event with students we're gonna do a week later. Right? But we did do like a lot of work nonetheless, right? And ultimately, for example, we did an event in Nazareth. I never thought I would go to Nazareth. I never thought I would be taking George Jackson to Nazareth, right? At this amazing Liwan Cafe, if you know Jonathan Cook's journalism work, or his partner Sally Azam, and there's a collective of folk, maybe five folk, who Nazareth is being gentrified, right, through tricks. The old city of Nazareth was tricked like into gentrification, where they lured businesses out for purposes of renovation, right, and cleaned them out and kept them empty for 8 years. But they haven't like filled it back up yet with design and stuff. So this group decided they were gonna like have a cafe that would put in the old city, whose reputation now was like, oh, it's dangerous, don't go there, like with the town, that's the propaganda. And that they would use this to try to like beat Zionism back to it, right, and produce a counter narrative for the old city. And this was an absolutely amazing experience. While I was there in October, we tried to organize an event in Bethlehem like 5 different times, and it never happened. At the end of October, they had held classes in Bethlehem twice, because Bethlehem and Hebron were like the hot points of this intifada of the night, okay? But when I came back to do the research interviews, right, we planned it and we made it happen. And then Hashabi Theater in Haifa, this amazing collective of young folk, recent university graduates put together a cooperative, right, accept no funding from the state, right, and do their thing. I was so honored to work with them. And this was like a really, really beautiful experience. This was season one of their program. And so every time anyone went to any event, and they do many events there, the exhibition would be there on display. And it ran from October 15th to January 17th. And I don't know where it goes. It could be like at Fatouche, you know, restaurant right now. Like we talked about that, right? Because you never know where anything goes. And it's really like quite like a privilege. I want to show you here the logo of the African Community Center, right, in the old city of Jerusalem. This is their logo. It appears on some versions of their glass doors, right, and this appears right at the doorway entrance to their hall. So the African Community Center of the old city of Jerusalem. It's next door to Al-Aqsa Mosque, the third holiest site in Islam. They are the guardians, like, of the mosque. And sometimes it's actually hard to get to the African Community Center because you have soldiers that are asking, are you Muslim? Are you Muslim? Right, and now you can't get through. You have to develop an attitude. You have to learn, right? You need black cultural literacy there too, and Palestinian cultural literacy, right? So you have to like, get out of my way, I'm going to that. And then no one bothers you. I had the honor of meeting like these huge Palestinian icons, right? Afro-Palestinian icons, since my first trip. Especially Malcolm Jinnah, who you're going to meet here. And I'd heard about Ali Jinnah, but I hadn't met like Ali Jinnah. And I met Ali Jinnah on this trip, right? And then I met a different family. I met the Kous family, right? And now they're all African, they're all related, right? I met the Kous family. And Musa Kous is the director of the African Community Center, like here, like in the old city. And we planned the exhibition for the African Community Center. We can't talk about Black Palestinian solidarity without recognizing there are Black Palestinians, right? Who actually represent a nexus, like a Palestinian radical, right? I often hear them say we're more Palestinian than the Palestinians, often. Often, and they're paid, right? When you try to walk the streets with Malcolm Jinnah, it's difficult. It reminds me of like, do the right thing in the mayor. Like, that's his image, right? It's hard to get places, he gets stopped by everyone, okay? And everyone knows like Ali Jinnah as well. This is my very first meeting, I look like a baby. Don't look at me, but he does make me look good. I take really good pictures with Ali Jinnah, with Malcolm Jinnah, for some reason. At the Jerusalem Hotel, this is Malcolm Jinnah, my first trip, right? We need to talk about Fatima Bernawi in the same way that Stokely Carmichael Kwame Ture talked about her. Go back to Stokely Speaks, right? Read the essay, Black and Palestinian Revolutions. It's amazing. And he ends his essay by saying, you upholding her as a paragon of revolution. This is who all of us need to be emulating, he says. Right? He's saying this to a group of Arab students, right? Saying all of us, Black, Arab, everybody, we need to follow her lead. This is the first female Palestinian political prisoner, like of record in the official accounting of Palestine. Everyone says this, right? And this Afro community is so proud of her, right? So in the same way we would think, say, of Leila Khaled, right? We would think of, right, Fatima Bernawi, okay? And also she's the woman, when for years, right, you know, in Zionism, like, takes hold of this, for years, people always ask when was Yasser Arafat gonna get married? For decades, right? And at one point, Yasser Arafat said, I wouldn't marry anyone. If I married anyone, I wouldn't marry Fatima Bernawi. So we're talking about like major icons here, right? This is a book published in 1990 by Ali Jinnah, very young, like Ali Jinnah, okay? So this is the Kous family. So I got to meet them this returning trip, right? And this is how I got to meet more of the African community there in that African quarter, right? In the long road is Aid Kous. Next to him is his brother, Musa Kous, right? There are about four or five brothers in their family. At one point, they were all in prison at the same time. And they all come from different organizations. One's PFLP, one's Fatah, one's Islamic Jihad, right? And it was through them that I got more information. There was a Sudanese political prisoner who was sent to fight with the PFLP, right? Who was actually adopted as their brother, and who did time as a political prisoner. I was hearing this from different interviews. We hear about people coming from Germany, the guy who comes from Japan, we hear about this all the time. We hadn't heard about someone coming from the Sudan to fight in the struggle, being captured, and being a political prisoner in Palestine, and then upon release, many years later, going back home, right? So I said, I've been hearing about this guy, Musa Noor. Do you guys know him? I'm like, oh yes, our mother adopted him. When she visited us, she visited him. When she sent packages with like underwear and food, she sent packages to him. He was our fifth brother. So this is the announcement in our Kous newspaper. I felt silly at one point when the exhibition got news coverage. Someone sent me a link for Al-Quds newspaper, but like, I didn't know. I was running all up and down the West Bank like a lunatic. I answered it quick on my phone because I didn't want to sell you to take it, right? So when I saw Al-Quds, and I've been working at Al-Quds University, I thought it was like a student newspaper, right? I thought it was a campus newspaper, but no, they're like, oh no, it's Jerusalem's New York Times, right? And Musa Kous works here. This was the announcement. So I felt like this was the climax of everything, to have the exhibition in the African Community Center, feet a stone's throw away from Al-Aqsa Mosque. Right? There's Musa and his son Muhammad. You can see the Jerusalem stone right here. This is for Afro-Palestinian youth checking out the exhibition. They like selfies. I want you to see them. Right? More pictures that you can actually find in the PNN story, Palestine News Network. Right? And Ali Jinnah speaking here. Like Ali Jinnah speaking. A political prisoner of 17 years. Mahmoud Jinnah of 19 years. PFLP folk, Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, known for the Night of Bombs. You can research that. He says at the exhibition, the African-Palestinian ex-prisoner Ali Jinnah is reported, in his word, said that he learned about Jackson through his writings in prison and praised his struggle, independence, and passion towards reading and writing in prison, saying that this represents an uncanny relationship between both black and Palestinian struggle, calling on Palestinians to walk in his shoe to reach freedom and independence. Okay? And it's uncanny. Like, the word I use all the time is uncanny. So then I read this translation from Ali in English, and it says uncanny, and I have experience on the uncanny. So what I found out that blew me away most, I would say, most, is that when I went back and did another interview with Mahmoud Jinnah, and then my first interview with Ali Jinnah, I found out that these two, iconic of the iconic, right, Palestinians, Afro-Palestinians, right, were part of what they call the Translators Committee of the Palestinian Captives Movement. I learned about this Palestinian academy, how they built a revolutionary school inside of the prison. It's amazing to me. How they smuggled out books through things they call capsules. Where they take a piece of paper, they write books on some small piece of paper and burn them into like little capsules, using plastic and smuggle them out and publish whole books that way. Books, political directives, etc. By swallowing them, defecating them, kissing them out when hitting the cheek, like etc. And so I was learning about this in detail over and over again. But then I found out, I didn't even know to ask the question. He lets me know that he and Mahmoud were part of the translators. There's a translators committee, right? And I'm like, well, how many people were part of it? Well, there were probably maybe four of us. And so it sounded like half of the translators committee of the captives movement in Palestine are Afro-Palestinians. This becomes interesting, right? Because now there's sort of two historical tracks or genealogies of black Africans in Palestine. So one, and this is the thing, I went back to Palestine, I spoke to Hadi Green, he goes, you have to come back and talk to us about them. So I felt like all this pressure to like learn, to get to make the contact, to get the interviews, etc. I'm like, shit, do I have enough yet? No. So there are two historical streams, right? There's a set of Africans who come making, as a part of their holy pilgrimages, to Mecca, and then you're supposed to go to Jerusalem after Mecca. Right? In 1948 and in 1967. In 48 and 67, when you have the onslaughts of the colonial violence, right? What's called Israeli independence in 48, which is a Nakba, and in 67, what's called the Six-Day War, when Israelis attack all the neighboring Arab countries and take the land which they haven't given back to Palestine, right? West Jerusalem, the West Bank that's occupied, etc. What happens is that those who come for the Holy Pilgrimage, some of them get trapped. Right, and don't get out. Others don't want to leave, they want to stay and fight, and they do fight, right? And this particular stream, which is more recent and reachable, right, represent Africans who are coming from predominantly Muslim countries in Africa, Chad, Senegal, Niger, and Sudan, okay? So these are the Africans who might be second or third generation who can tell you where their fathers came from. But then you have a longer diaspora, which is more like our diaspora here, longer. So you can't say my father came from here, because you've been here a long time. Longer, most likely, longer than we've been here in the Americas, okay? I also want to say here that we have many Pan-African imaginations that don't see Palestine as disconnected from the African continent, right? When we remember that one of the Palestinian borders via Gaza is Egypt, and we don't forget Egypt is Africa because Western Academy tells us it's not, right? Then we can't disconnect Africa and Palestine. So this is why I want to go back to the logo of the African Community Center of the Old City, like of Jerusalem. Look what it does. Look at that corner, right, in the northeast. It takes the continent of Africa, it affixes the contours of the whole country of Palestine to the northeast, and within the country, the shape of Palestine, you see the Al-Aqsa Mosque representing Jerusalem. And so it makes Palestine a part of Africa in the same way that Cape Verde or Madagascar would be. I think this is an amazing, very, very important intervention at the level of the imagination. Right? And this is why Kwame Ture himself will refer to Palestine as the tip of Africa. At the end of that essay that I'm referring to you, he says, I have two dreams, and that my dreams are rooted in reality. He says, I have two dreams. One, I want to sip mint tea in Palestine. And then I want to be with my wife in South Africa, Miriam McCabe. Right? And so this is a Pan-African imagination, very subtle, right? That Africa has the tip that is Palestine and the tip that is South Africa, right? So, you know, I certainly don't want to endanger anybody, so before we publish any material, I would send things, you know, to folks. Like, is this okay? Is this okay? So here's the story, Musa, is this okay? You know, so when the story appeared, it was ready to go. I was like, here's the story, here are the pictures, is this okay? And he says, he writes me a note, it's Facebook Messenger, right, which is a telephone there, and says, it is great, I am happy for hosting it, that's not the important part. He must always remember that you have brothers in the heart of Jerusalem. So one of the other things on my agenda, which was attached to the Haile Gerima message, right, was this. I kept hearing in my interviews with all Palestinian ex-prisoners that I was interviewing, ex-prisoners who become new prisoners, re-prisoners at the time. I was hearing about these brothers, these African brothers in Jericho, right? I wanted more information about Jericho. Jericho is very much seen as a black space in Palestine, right? Jericho isn't just a biblical metaphor. It's occupied Jericho, occupied Palestine, where there's U.S. militarism, Israeli militarism, where there's neo-colonial Palestinian Authority prison, right? And they're struggling. They're taking all the water, for example. Right? It used to be an agricultural space, but now it can't be because, as someone said here, like the trees are dried up because they've stolen all the water. So I knew, I had come to know that like one of the first people you expect black people in Palestine is Jericho. Right? This is a kind of basic, like psycho-visual narrative, right? And so Ayik Kous told me on my fourth trip, when you come back for the exhibition at Hashemi Theater, when you come back, I take you to Jericho. I need you to look at him. He needs to go to Jericho. I didn't want to go to Jericho. I take you to Jericho, right? So we had to do this. I'm all anxious about it, like we work it out. Ayik says, we're going to go Thursday. Meet me across from the Damascus Gate. It's fine. We're going to go to Jericho, right? We go from Servis to Servis, minibus to minibus, tap, tap, to tap, tap, right? We get to Abu Dis, we want the minibus that's going to Jericho, and Ayik looks at me and goes, two black guys on the side of the road must be going to Jericho. We don't know this, and yet we have this movement that we're going to talk a little bit about later. There's a name for Jericho here, that's for black political prisoners. So I heard about these two brothers, they're African brothers, so we don't know if like, they're nuclear brothers, or nuclear cousins, and maternal, like Uncle Seth's, right? They're family, like they are brothers. Ahmad Takruri and Juma Takruri. Right? The woman you see here at the center of this picture, these are their brothers, right? And this woman, Rukaya Takruri, was a major like figure like in Jericho in terms of women's leadership and this family. Whenever anything happens politically in Jericho, the Israelis show up at their door, right? So their two brothers were given life sentences, right? One was released in a prisoner swap relatively recently and deported to Gaza. Gaza is seen as an open-air prison, so you can release people and take them there. That's how the Zionism thinks, actually, right? The other was beginning, at the moment of this contact, was beginning his 30th year in prison, right? And this was uncanny for me, too. I could, you know, we go to Jericho, we go right to their house, right? It was uncanny for me because they're in Jericho. We had done a day trip on one of my, that first delegation trip I took. We took a day trip. We went to the Dead Sea in the morning. We passed through a sycamore tree. It's supposed to be the oldest tree, like anywhere, because Jericho is the oldest city in the history of human life, right? So, of course, it's black. Right. And then we go to this other thing, like the Mount of Temptation. It was just like, let's go, whatever. The Mount of Temptation, right? It's where like the 40 days and 40 nights, for you Christians, the 40 days and 40 night place. I'm a heathen, so I got to study this stuff. I don't know, right? So, and you have this monastery. It's like 1,500 meters or something, like in the sky up in the mountain, and you take a cable car, and it's very scary, like that high, over to the mountain where this monastery is carved. You see all these like old people climbing up, right, to go to this church, called the Mount of Temptation. And of course, it's like a giant sort of tourist destination. And we went this one day on my first trip. We had one day off. What do we do? What else can we see? Right? So, to my surprise, they live under the Mount of Temptation, around the corner from the telephone cable car. Wow. You know, I had already been here in the neighborhood and didn't know, and their village is, as they say, probably 99% black. I had no idea. I was coming back, I thought, we've already met. This was like a running theme, right, of my experience. And they tell me the story that their two brothers set up bombs in an Israeli bus under the occupation, right? And Jericho was supposedly presented as a space of like quietude, and that was blown up, right? And they became legends. And as usual, the Israelis demolished their homes and wouldn't let them rebuild it for 14 years. And when she told me that they have suffered and that they live in tents along the Jordan River, and I think about the Jordan River like in our experience, like I can't believe my ears. You know, like I can't believe my ears. And how the political imprisonment continues, as in other cases, to duplicate itself generation after generation, right? So at one point, 8 of the 11 of them were in prison at the same time, and now they have nephews, right? One who's serving a 44-year prison. This is the Takuri family, right? And so, and they were amazing. And the thing I'll say, you'll read this one day, is that this is an incredibly, you know, formidable woman in particular who really told most of the story. And she told the story like it was a blues song, right? With incredible strength, I would say. Now, after the counter-revolution against the 60s and the 70s here, right, we get a small movement in the 90s, right, that tries to focus and bring attention to political prisons in the U.S., using the traditional language of political imprisonment, right? And actually name it the Jericho Movement. They take the biblical metaphor, right, of Jericho, they turn it around. Now it's not really about invading Jericho for like Judeo-Christian conquest, but instead it's about, well, you want to talk about tearing down walls, tear down prison walls, right? And this is really led by Safia Boukhari. Really led by Safia Boukhari, who dies too soon of cancer, who's an amazing, amazing figure, right? And so they fought for the people, and now it's time to bring them home, right? With many people trying to get presidential appeals, presidential pardons, and what have you, you know, for them. And the White House wouldn't even say the name or even recognize the appeals of black political prisoners. Even when they accepted Oscar Lopez and denied an appeal, they didn't recognize, right, these. Very interesting. Safia Boukhari has some writings collected after her untimely passing. It's called The War Before, the true life story of becoming a Black Panther, keeping the faith in prison, and fighting for those left behind. Safia Boukhari collected her writings, which are amazing, right? Is this one piece in particular. It's a tribute to fallen comrades called Lest We Forget. Most of the piece is a kind of biographical call where she recalls all of them in truncated biographical form, right? And then the piece ends with a recitation of a poem that is Enemy of the Sun by Samuel Kassam via George Shaston. And what we see here is that she turned it into a kind of pretext, right? So she changes the last stanza and replaces the reference to Ulysses and makes it a reference to the Don Camote of the Mau Mau King, right? So the poem kept living new lives after the publication of the Black Panther Party newspaper from East Coast to West Coast. And really for decades and decades, really up until the exhibition, most people who encountered the poem in the Black Panther newspaper or via George Jackson continued to think of it as a Black Panther poem or a George Jackson poem. It was used to actually like bring people into the party and to recruit. Right, and this is like 1991, which is when she did it, and the book was published, you know, in the last 10 years, right? Then there's Amir Baraka, right? Rest in power, right? Who gave a piece to this collection called Poets for Palestine. Poets for Palestine opens with a poem by Mahmoud Darwish, who's now considered Palestinians, the kind of Palestinian national poet. At the publication of Enemy of the Sun, Samir Kassam was a larger poet, right, than Darwish, right? Things like have changed. After Darwish in this collection is Amir Baraka, who gives us a poem called Enemy of Civilization. He writes, "The Palestinians call you enemy of the sun, from a bunker, barely able to see the sky. No, not just enemy of the sun, but enemies of life and the word, enemies of humanity and of civilization itself." So now Acosta becomes the Palestinians, right? And I actually think that if you look at this poem as somebody who loves America, they go together and they really represent a suite like of poems, and you can't separate them. So I invite people to read them in just this way. This all takes us beyond our hashtags. So I wanted to learn more about this Black Panther and Palestinian connection, because you actually have at least two different formations of Black Panthers in historic Palestine. One in the early 70s, one in the mid to late 80s, right? And I wanted to learn as much as I could like about this, right? So we have the Mandela iconography. We actually have the iconography of South Africa, which comes to a head with this giant Mandela statue in Ramallah, which was recently like unveiled, right? Which is powerful. At the same time, it's a kind of state-to-state commemoration, right? But we have this Panther connection that I wanted to learn more about too, right? So as settler colonialism, Zionism wanted to create what it called the Israeli state, and to, as all colonialism, to like promote and inflate its numbers to justify it as the Jewish thing, which is really this Euro-Jewish thing. And so as they did with coolie labor in the Caribbean, right, by hook or crook, they wanted to bring Arabs, Jews from Arab lands, to the settler colonial state, right, in order to promote the numbers of Jews to say it's a Jewish state, and also to use it as cannon fodder, middlemen, and black labor, Schwarzi labor. And Arab Jews at the time, the term Arab Jew was used interchangeably with the term black Jews, Arab Jews, black Jews, Schwarzi labor, etc. The racism, as many would say, predated them by years, because they were seen as primitive Jews, Jews that were too Arab, too Middle Eastern, like, etc., right? Jews from Arab lands, right, who have been living, you know, in that juxtaposition for 2,000 years, okay? And that group would create Black Panthers, called Black Jews, brought to do black labor. They would create a group called the Black Panthers in Hebrew, all right? I want to show you some images. It's mostly known in terms of a ghetto neighborhood called Musrara that's right on the line that came to be known as the dividing line between East and West Jerusalem. So they would absorb shots from the Jordan border, right? The logo is the same for each of these formations. Each is the same, right? They grew afros, they threw fists up, right? Everything, right? They used the same rhetoric. They indulged in performance theater of politics, right? Both visually as well as oratorically, right? Now, like everything else, there's a little bit of a tourist thing that happens. They renamed some of the streets. They were like, it kind of began in prison. They were young, they were poor. Many didn't go to school past sixth grade. And they were like teenagers in the main, but they ended up getting a meeting with Golda Meir. It's very famous. It's almost a cliche now where she says, after the meeting, she says, I got details about the meeting now, right? And like smoking, covering her in smoke and everything. And she says, after the meeting, she makes a statement to the press. She says, they're not nice boys. And they ended up renaming one of their streets, They're Not Nice Alley. This is Ruben Abrigel, who blows me away. He reminds me of what I see here in terms of the afterlife of the Black Panther Party, especially the intellectual life, the revolutionary intellectual life, and the afterlife of the Black Panther Party. This is an amazing guy, an amazing guy. And this him, when I interviewed him on one of my last days, right, he had this picture hanging up. This is him dressed as a panther. So. He was one of the core founders. He was the oldest member, the only one who had like a house and was married. And one day he went to organize in Haifa, and they came back, and the Israelis had destroyed his house, which is the center, like, of the group, right? And then actually goes on for years. He's an amazing intellectual voice. He used to have, like, a website where he put all these articles, right, like in Hebrew, and they destroyed the site, right, and none of the material was saved. So this has gone on for a long time. An amazing figure. I think of Elaine Brown and Dorubi Mahad when I think of Ruud Abrigel in this particular way. Family coming from Morocco. And he'll be in the United States soon. Which is kind of rare. He also makes this incredible identification with the Palestinian struggle, right? Which is often hard to do in the divide and conquer structure of Zionism. But there's like scant work like on these Black Panthers, but there's something of a presence. And when you see that presence, they tend to do two things. There's a kind of closet liberal Zionism, right, narrative that creates where they try to contain it. And they say it only lasted for 2 years and it was only in Jerusalem. Right? But the surveillance records and the testimony says no. It was all over. That's why they went to Haifa and came back, right, in his house. Right? I have been demolished. And then I found out by talking to him directly that a kind of second wave of Panthers has started producing a really revolutionary literature, including like these two texts that he wants to see translated.
It's upside down.
Yeah, we have a slide problem, sorry. We tried to fix it. There's two slides missing too, but we'll work it out. So, and this is him talking about a direct line of the abuses from the 1950s to the racism we see in Israeli society today. In 2015, when there are protests against racism against Ethiopians, right? And on that side of the green line, okay? So this is the Pantherine, right? The Black Panther formation in Hebrew, which has gotten the attention that we see any of when we talk about Black Panthers in historical Palestine. What I didn't know until recently, there's a Black Panther formation in Arabic, right? The Fahed al-Aswad, which is closer to us, but it's in Arabic and we don't know it. So the first Intifada, the underground wing of Fatah, the dominant political representation in PLO, that a lot of the different political wings had their undergrounds and they gave them different names. So the Red Group, the PFLP, their underground was called the Red Eagle. And Fatah's underground was called the Fahed al-Aswad, right? Or the Black Panther. This is closer to us in time. It's like mid-1980s, late 1980s. All the way through Oslo, or the mid-1990s. It's closer to us in time, and it's also coming from the PLO, which we already have like an intellectual, if not a political relationship with, and we all know it, right? And actually, I've talked to a lot of like Palestinians who think of it in Arabic and don't make the association, like, oh yeah, that is Black Panther, isn't it? Right, for example. And I had to ask a lot of questions and learn a lot of things, and I met a few. And there are different narratives that keep expanding like the more you push it, right? So oftentimes people will say, oh, it started in Nablus, and it spread to Jenin, but it was only in Nablus and Jenin, right? So here are two brothers, the most famous brothers, the founders, right, of this piece of it that's in Nablus. And they were assassinated along with 13 people overall in a barbershop by the Israelis in the old city of Nablus. This is their barbershop. Right, and if you look at the barbershop, you can see that it kind of renamed itself and gave itself that Panther logo, like on top, as a result. And then it was sent to spread to Jenin, and to really grow in Jenin, which is north of Nablus, right? And this was interesting. They dealt with collaborators, like in South Africa, in a sense, right? But they also did some above ground stuff, okay? And their logo and their image was big enough to really be broadcast throughout the West Bank because they became a symbol for other folk. So I've talked to like younger Palestinians who dressed up as Black Panthers in Bethlehem, right? Not even knowing that there was a Fatah association, for example, right? I had this question in part because a couple of years ago, Omar Zayed was assassinated in the Bulgarian embassy, right? In Sofia, clearly by the Israelis. And he had been lodged there for like 20 years, had a Bulgarian wife, right? He was a former political prisoner in Palestine. He tricked his way out of prison. I heard once that he faked a hunger strike. No, I had two things. One, that he went on a hunger strike, and one, that he faked mental illness. In either case, I think it was a hunger strike. They transferred him to a hospital, and he escaped from the hospital. Ends up in Bulgaria, stays in the embassy for 20 years, but then they assassinate him with the collusion, right, of the embassy they've been trying, and also the silent complicity of the PA. And then I found out in a few stories I was trying to read in translation, he had been identified as a Black Panther before I knew anything. Before I knew anything, right? But then I found this other question, which is very interesting. When I talked to some people in the past, they're like, oh, he was from one of the left groups, no? Right? The Red Eagle group, maybe. But then other folks says, oh, he could have started in one and went to another. But later on, when I went back to Jenin and I talked to the director of the Red Eagle formation, he said, some people will tell you that these underground groups were separate, right, and restricted to party affiliation. This is untrue. There was major coordination in prison. I was still meeting people who were executing orders, right, that I had given and didn't know who they were or where they were coming from, including outside of Palestine. And I was constantly like meeting them. There was constant coordination, right? And so I thought that after this project, I want to do as much as I can, right, for us to be able to like let the rest of the world stand up and say, when this happens in Bulgaria, to say, oh, they just killed the Black Panther. And we can make the proper identification and proceed accordingly. This is a flyer for the guys in Nablus, right, when they have their revolutionary memorial service, known by some as a funeral. There is a sign that's in Nablus above the thing. And this is an image that was given to me to someone in Bethlehem, a former political prisoner who was a journalist. And this is two guys who were identified as Fahed Black Panther being arrested in Ida Camp in Bethlehem. Right? Ultimately, I would find new information keeps coming my way the more I talk to people, the more they discover. We can think about politics of archiving here or whatever, in different language, of course. But then I found out that it's likely actually to be planned. It was planned in Lebanon. It was planned in Lebanon and really begun in Gaza, right? And the work in Gaza was most diffuse, right? So the beginnings of the actual practice is probably Gaza, all over Gaza, in a very intense way, even before it gets to the West Bank, where some narratives think it just began in Nablus and Muti Jenin. So those are the two like formations of historic Palestine, one in Hebrew, one in Arabic, and then of course we have the Black Panther Party of Oakland itself celebrating its 50th anniversary. Here is an ecstatic Huey P. Newton meeting Arafat, right? I think they're just passing each other in the airport. We don't have the full story yet. The Huey P. Newton of the Black Panthers who said, Israel was created by Western imperialism and maintained by Western firepower. We support the Palestinians' just struggle for liberation 100%. We will go on doing this, and we would like for all of the progressive people of the world to join our ranks in order to make the world a place in which all people can live. They released three statements in 70, 74, and then after Huey P. Newton went to Lebanon in 1980. And this photo comes from in front of a Palestinian refugee camp, right, with Palestinian youth, right? So I'm doing this. I come back after 3.5 months to participate in the 50th anniversary conference and gala of the Black Panther Party for 3 days at the Oakland Museum. We set up part of the exhibit. But it can only be part of the exhibit, and now it's actually in the main, a new part. We have some of the pillars of the original exhibit, but now I'm going to add like some different like images, right? Many of the people that I interviewed, the Palestinian ex-captives that I interviewed, we went back to get some videotape footage, right? And it began with this amazing woman right here, who is too much for words, right? And I wanted to give her a gift, because right, I love her pieces. And think she's like very cosmic, right? I wanted to give her a gift, and I thought, well, I can't give one person a gift. And then this whole idea came, where we took pictures of Palestinian ex-captives holding up, right, in a very Palestinian way, right? Images of George Jackson. This is the director of the Abu Jihad Center, and the head of research at the Abu Jihad Center, to hold up George Jackson in the same way that this struggle held up Palestinian resistance poetry at the same time. And this is, Hawash, right, an amazing figure herself, who talked about her proud flesh after her experiences of torture. As it turns out, Ahlan Wahash. This is Ali Jiddah, who I think is Legba at this point, to be honest, with his red wall. And Musa Kous, himself, the director of the African Community Center, another flawed slide. This is Aisha Oda, the very, very famous Aisha Oda, of her own prison narratives, right? Probably one of the foremost pioneers among the women prisoners in the 70s who came out with a literary narrative and testimony about the torture of women when the Israelis were very concerned about the role that women could play in the Palestinian struggle. Something that Fatima Bernawi talked about herself when she claimed her own action as a success. She goes, now every time a woman walks into a theater, they have to like wonder, right? Every time they see the Algerian Revolution, every time they see a woman with a bag, they have to wonder. And she said, of course they came after the African women first, right? And so this is Aisha Oda. We're in the NGO era of neocolonialism. And so like many, many, many Palestinians are very sick and tired of being interviewed by anybody, right? I knew, right, the right people in the struggle to get an introduction. But the other thing was, as we come to a close, is that a lot of these people were willing to be interviewed because the subject was Black Panthers. Right, and because the interviewer was coming from the Black world, right? And so when I met Aisha Oda, who's sick and tired of interviews, like every other line out of her mouth was like, I don't like interviews. I'm sick and tired. And interviews coming from all different ideological angles. She said, but when I found out that today it was about a Black Panther, I said, when and where? This is Reuben himself, Abu Jahl, and Palestinian ex-prisoners from inside the 48 boundaries colonized in Israel. This is an Ida camp. You can see the apartheid wall. A lot of the prisoners, not only do they like represent the Revolutionary Academy that they build inside the prison, when they get out, they go to school. They join MA programs, finish MA programs, or start new ones, for example. He went to Al-Quds saw the exhibition, and when he saw one of the panels, he read the description and said, this is my story. This is what happened to me, right? This is exactly what happened to me, and no one knows this experience until they're put in this position. The last thing we should do. Right? I have to worry about saying too much and identifying people, right, to food. And so we took those images that represented something, and then I took them to the exhibition in Oakland, right? And those images became part of the exhibition in Oakland. And when we were mounting it, I was mounting it as other Panthers, these old Panthers were there doing what they were doing for the exhibit. They would walk by and look around and go, George! George, right? You know, so who are these other people? And when they found out who these other people were, and we had bios and fixed here, ultimately, they were like, again, like Paul Coates, right on. Right? That identification remained. Missing slide. And we got images of other Panthers, as many as I could in this conference, which was very hectic. Standing with them in the same way that they're holding up George after George held up the resistance poetry. Right? And this is one of the Panthers that came from New Zealand, right? The Polynesian Panthers. And he was already wearing his Free Palestine t-shirt. Emory Douglas. This is Bruce Dixon, if you read Black Agenda Report. He's a former Panther himself. Right? He took the picture and then said, I want a picture of you. Then he came back later with his wife and a friend who was taking pictures and put them on Facebook. This, my heart, is Charlotte O'Neill. Right? Charlotte and Paul O'Neill, who've been living in Tanzania for 40 years, who were Panthers out of Kansas City. Left when I think she was even 19 and lived in Algiers with the Black Panther International section for 2 years before moving on to Tanzania. She saw George, I want a picture with George, she said. And she posed with her Panther tattoo on her shoulder. She's, I don't have words for her. I don't have words for her. And Elaine Brown. That was the 50th. This is the Martyrs of George painted in, right? And I wanted to talk about how it all gives like new meaning. Right, to George Jackson in the Sun of Palestine. When I first came up with the title, the last thing I want to say, when I first came up with the title, I wanted the words to make people envision George Jackson alive, immortal, and escaped. That he could be somewhere else, right, outside of like the narrative. And I wanted that flexibility, like, and ambiguity. And it made sense, because in Soul There, Brother, I invite you to go back, he always talks about escaping and leaving over here. Right? Before there's a revolutionary momentum afoot, right? He talks about going to the Indian Ocean, the Maldives Islands, to Tanzania. He says, I'll see Ghana yet, right? And he says, I'm more of a Che type cat than a Fidel, right? So he could be in Bolivia to be exporting revolution like all over the world. And then there's a passage where he says, you know, I've been working on my language studies, he writes. I'll end you with this. He says, my language studies on October 18, 1967. My language studies are coming along well. I guess if I don't get out before January, and it's not very likely that I will, I'll go into Arabic next. With four languages, plus English, I'll be able to communicate with three-fourths of the people on Earth. I am presently working on Spanish and Swahili. Swahili is spoken by most peoples from Mexico to Chile, in what is the fastest growing population area in the world. Swahili is spoken by all of Eastern Africa. I may find communication with these people important in my work. It's the work of revolution. All that remains is for me to learn Arabic and Chinese. Thank you.
So I want to thank Professor Greg Thomas for doing the kind of work that Africana Studies was set up to do, take the discussion further, make the international links, and bring a lot of the pieces together. And I'm so proud of you.
Thank you.
We will take a couple questions.
Thank you.
After the program.
Thank you.
Couple questions, please. Yes, there's one in the back.
I was just
saying.
Hi, everyone. So I was interested in your idea of neutralizing sort of the white editor, neutralizing the black writer. And I read that reissued Soul Dead Brother with the foreword by Jonathan Jackson Jr. And I was wondering if you think, you know, was that a way for the family to sort of seize control of the narrative, or again, or what are your opinions about that? I was just wondering.
So, Solid Air Brother had different audiences, and the dominant audience was a liberal audience, right? Predominantly white liberal audience. And one that was scared of revolution, right? And then one could only read him once revolution had been framed out, like, of the text. 200 pages are missing from that text. The opening autobiographical letter is cut 75%, right? There were things that went into the publication that weren't supposed to be there, right? And there were things that were changed, like pronouns are changed. Right, when George Jackson's writing a letter, he's not writing a letter, and he's not writing to, like, the addressee. The addressee is a pretext. It's like, the only way I can get out is by saying, dear Faye, right? But then Faye Stinton would, like, change things around in the text, changing the pronouns to make it seem like he was appealing to her to, like, save black people, things like this, right? And from research, I actually, like, get him in his own voice talking about this. And he actually wrote and said word by his sister, like, I want her fired. As the legal association to make the termination. Then the tactician in them said, wait, like, we'll do it this way, okay? But it's important for us to know the history, which gets repressed, and there's a lot of revisionism that comes from the ex-left, right, of the 60s, right? So that's one thing. So when Blood of My Eye is published, the same liberal audience, predominantly white liberal audience, is like, it's just not as poetic as the first book, right? But also they've jetted on revolutionary struggle. Those assassinations do ideological work. Right, they make people flee, like from radical politics, you know, like a stink bomb. And so it was a different story. And so I don't know how I pinpoint dates like this, like when they went out of print, I'm not quite sure. But they don't come back into print until the 90s. And after Paul Coates puts Blood of My Eye in print, Jonathan Jackson, who didn't have a relationship with the Jackson family, he was born after Jonathan's death, and actually wasn't recognized by the rest of the Jackson family, he took the opportunity to put it back in print. Right, but it's still the same text that it was in 1970. Okay, so and this is actually the mission of Black Classic Press, which is not to like retype like the manuscript or change anything around, but to just make it accessible to us again. And that's what Lawrence Hill Press did. So what it did in the 90s is to put it back in print after the counter revolution had removed it from print, more or less.
Very simple question. Has Angela Davis seen your exhibit?
I don't know if she's seen it.
If you don't know, then it must
mean
she hasn't seen it.
I mean, she certainly knows of it. She certainly knows of it. But I get this question. The very common question is like, in very polite company.
Can you let my students know that information because I told them.
Okay.
That's one of the big things.
All right. This is interesting. So, Angela Davis really becomes an international icon through the George Jackson relationship. Okay, so she becomes very newsworthy when she's fired by the UC Board of Regents. You know, she comes back from Germany, a student of Marcuse, teaches at UCLA while she's matriculated at UC San Diego for the PhD program. And the head of the Board of Regents for the university system in California is the governor. So who is that?
Reagan.
So they get wind of this. She's not hiding anything, but they get wind of this. And they try to use McCarthy era legislation to fire her, and they do. They have to like reinstitute her, but then there's this trial period, and there's this hot stuff going on. So George Jackson is incredibly slick, right? So he politically socialized these younger brothers through letters that were not meant to be seen by anyone else. So there are all kinds of letters that are not meant to be seen by other people either, right? And he positioned them in certain ways, and they would all be like multitasking. Go here and do this, and he's like, it's an amazing way. You have to read George with Fanon to Dying Colonialism, the Algerian family chapter, to see how you like do this kind of work. So he tells Jonathan that he should hang around Angela, who now, among many other people, are part of the Soledad Brothers Defense Committee. Many other people. George Jackson is correspondent with many, many, many people of different ages, sexes, etc. But what we get in bourgeois society is this romance, right, that is pitched, where there was a romance, not a political relationship, and it's all personal and individual. This is something that he also decried about the publication of Soledad Brother. Why are there these limited amount of letters with her that are all about personal rather than like political things, okay? But also, where are all the other letters? He corresponded with Alice Yarrick. She was a 63-year-old white woman who had amazing testimony about how she felt when she went in with very liberal attitudes and ended up crying. And says, how did I come to be a white woman means sitting here being mothered by this young black prisoner? Like some powerful stuff, right? But what we get is like, oh, there was a romance, right? And even academic scholarship, where like Dylan Rodriguez, you know, says that Angela Davis and George Jackson were like, you know, what did he say, like, the grandparents like of the movie, like, what the hell are you doing, right? So it's really crazy. It came to my vision most fully when I learned from actually like a former colleague in Binghamton that this is a common strategy in Latin America, where they actually pitch, except he didn't do this, but where it's common for folk to pitch, you know, prisoners in isolation, like as a couple in counter propaganda moves, like in the state. But the Communist Party, Angela's party, despised George, was threatened by him, and made major smear campaigns against him that didn't work, right? This is all like very, very messy. So it's part of that, like, you know, messy, very bourgeois sort of campaign. And in fact, if you actually read George, he's talking about like her attitudes on fascism come from the Communist Party line, which comes from the 30s and 40s, and which is an escape from reality. And like the language they like to use was to say that the Black Panther Party was the only Communist Party, right, in the United States, like, or in North America. So this is where like the question comes from in general, right? But there's two questions I would get whenever anyone heard about my research. Like, oh, have you interviewed Angela Davis? And have you interviewed Johnny Spain, who was one of the San Quentin Six, who was also rejected by the rest of the Six for all kinds of things that he has done, like in the wake like of that history. And it's funny that the two people I get asked about all the time are the two people who have avoided me the most. That's what I think.
So as always, Greg Thomas, I just want to echo what Carol said. To me, your work just embodies the rigor and beauty of global Black studies. So thank you for being in this world. There are too many things you know, Greg. You teach me more than anybody can teach me. That's all I can say. There's so many things I would call out. I think of that one moment, Greg, where you said that Pan-Africanism allows us to remap Africa itself, so it includes Palestine. Right? But here's what I want to say, because I want everyone else to hear what you've already told me. So I remember when you were telling me you're in Palestine, you're teaching Black arts movement poetry, right? Can you tell us? You know, of course, I'm thinking about Morocco and all the folks we love. Tell us, like, what people are grabbing onto, you know, when you're teaching Black arts movement poetry, what are they holding on to?
So before this project started, in my second trip to Palestine, when I was trying to like get me, it's a third world space, right? You don't kind of, a lot of times when you're only dealing with NGO liberalism, you're dealing with people from the outside who only know Palestine, and they can't put any of it in context, and it leads to like silly stuff, right? So like I go and I'm like fed until I'm 20 pounds heavier, right? And people are extending themselves in amazing ways, but the timeline is very different at the same time. So the second time I come, I'm there because I'm trying to have meetings with the Abu Jihad Center folk, because email ain't working, and neither is the phone. It ain't done like that, right? So I have to go back to get meetings, right? And when I'm there, the contacts I made before, they teach like HBCUs. Four classes every semester, four classes during the summer. They teach like HBCUs. So I get invited by the people I made friends with, right, to come and speak to their classes, right? And the first ones are Hebron in the very Islamic south of the country, and the other ones more north in Nablus, right, in Nablus. And I go, the thing is with Zionism, like, I can't come prepared. I can't come bringing anything, right? So, one, I gotta go with what I know, which is a female, right? And anything I can pull from my inbox, right? You know, they photocopy all their books. The reason why we did this exhibition is because they kept smiling at me whenever we had general conversations saying, we have no copyright law in Palestine. I would have never dreamed of trying an exhibition if I thought I needed to secure any kind of copyrights, right? So I decided at these universities, which were tend to be 70% female, right, and hijabi, right, that the ideal thing to do would be able to talk about Malcolm and how every piece of Malcolm destabilizes every piece of the construct of American literature, right? Because they're getting all this money from USAID, right? And like the British did with the British imperialism, they established an American center, right? This whole propaganda mission. And so those are like the first lectures, right? And then when I came back, we talked about all of the poetry, right? People know about the connection between June Jordan and Suhail Hamad, right? They don't know that Susan Abu Hawa, for some reason they don't talk about how Susan Abu Hawa joined that suite with a poem called Black, that is the most orthodox Black arts movement poem that you can imagine, that's coming now in the 2000s from Palestine, rather than here in the 60s and the 70s, right? It's a Black aesthetic, Black arts poem in every way. But then I add to it, because we discovered the poetry of Laini Mataka, right? And Laini Mataka remixed the poem by Marvin X, who's now a imam, right? And then she has like five or so poems for Palestine in her latest collection published by Black Classic Press called The Prince of Kokomo. Okay, so that becomes part like of the mix, and then I get a Baraka, right, which I stumbled onto. And this poetry is different from the poems that might be held up, you know, in sort of liberal pro-Palestinian spaces, right? You're not going to hear Laini Mataka in those spaces, right? Talking the way she talks about Black folks like in Palestine, right? And they identify with it totally in the same way they identify with George Jackson. Right, whether it was like the older folk who might have been political ex-prisoners, or like the younger folk, like who were activists. And I mean, I didn't just speak in university context; there were youth movements, political movements that I also like had built relationships with. And sometimes I gave a talk to not the youth movement, right? And then in an audience was like an ex-political prisoner I had read about, and you know, and lectured about. Right? And I didn't find out until later when he invited me to my house that I realized he was this very famous lecturer from the Palestinian prisoner movement, a lecturer inside the prison who then published the lectures later in book form, and told me from the audience that he knew a Black Panthers traveling out of the U.S. who got military training in Lebanon, right, with Palestinians, right? And so just in the same way they identify with the George Jackson story, I mean, Mahmoud Jadid would tear up and only think about his PFLP comrades when I first told him this story, right? And they remembered him because they were the translators committee, right? And then younger folk, you know, who identify with, you know, the stories about George's mother saying that she'll always have sons all across the world whenever anybody is fighting for freedom, right? And they interrupt everything like with applause, right? So, and the poetry just makes it easier, right? Because they also have a hip-hop movement.
Okay.
Okay,
so we
want to
thank Professor
Wallace. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
go to the dinner, so. So you can send it. You can use quotes and send it to the first one. Yes.
they do say that you're
Yeah.